Hello, and thanks for tuning back into Let's Play Planescape Torment Blind. I'm the RPG Chick. We spoke to Koror here. We're in the lower ward. What? Oh, okay. Alright, I thought I was looking at another place because it said the marketplace. Oh, okay, so we've got a bunch of stuff here. It's all mapped out already, of course, because we're outside, I suppose. It's back to the alley. Entrance to the Great Foundry is the marketplace. Marketplace. Warehouse. Print shop. Siege tower. A wrecked house. Pawn shop. Coffin maker. And this goes to the upper ward. And someone's stolen away Mort. So we gotta find him. He's not with us. That's the person I talked to already. You see a middle-aged woman with yellow skin. She glances at you as you approach and tries to wave you away. Greetings. She looks at you apprehensively. Hello, Cutter. She begins to look about, searching the shadows for anyone that may be hidden there. You want something? I have some questions. Like what? Can you tell me about this ward? This here's the lower ward, home of the common folk like myself. Not much else to know about. Just look around and discover it for yourself. Someone stole a skull that I had. I'm trying to find it. She frowns at you, then makes a curious gesture over her heart. I've heard stories. She pauses. Some folks say there's a necromancer, or a priest of the dead, or some such thing in this ward. He collects skulls for some reason I can't fathom. You know where I can find him? She shakes her head slowly. Stories, Cutter. That's all it is. No such thing exists in this ward. It's just stories. Thank you. Farewell. There's a few named people and stuff around. Let's talk to Vorten. He looks pretty fearful. You see a harmonium officer. He gives you a bored look as you approach. Greetings. He gives you a bored look. Greetings, citizen. Measure 3 Vorten at your service. I have some questions. He sighs. I don't mean to be rude, but I am on duty and have no time for questions. He pauses. If you would like information, go talk to Ebb Creekneys. Okay, he's in that bar. The Burning Corpse Bar. Who is Ebb Creekneys? He's an old friend of mine. I think he considers himself to be a tout now, so he can give you the chant concerning just about anything. Where do I find him? Thinks for a moment. Last I heard, he pretty much set himself up in the Smoldering Corpse Bar. Sorry, not Burning Corpse, Smoldering Corpse Bar. You can find it somewhere down the hive. Thank you. Farewell. Miss Koror. Let's talk to Kina. Kina! This woman has a yellow cast to her skin and severe features. Tattoos cover her body, and she wears a long blade at her side. Her eyes are like 2 small black pearls. As you approach her, they follow Dakan's movements. Before you reach her, Dakan breaks in. I would have you hear me. No, be silent. What is it, Dakan? It is my will that we not speak to this woman. Why not? She is a Xerth. Our wills are crossed blades. We have no common ground. Then do not speak to her. Why do you insult the unbroken circle of Xerthamon by continuing to wear it against your heart? You are not numbered among the people, betrayer of Shraktalor. The Anarchs and the Xerths have spoken, and their words shall be obeyed. You are not to speak your mind to me, or to any Xerth. What? Oh, that's Kina talking. Dakan, will you hear this human when he speaks? His words carry the weight of yours and have the shape of Limbo's form. I will not hear you, Dakan. He travels with me, Kina, disciple of Xerthamon. He comes to you to hear the words of Xerthamon, which you, as a Xerth, must impart. Will you hear him? The words of Xerthamon are not for the ears of a human to be heard. Their minds are not as one, and they bring division wherever they travel. This one wears a shirt of scars and blood, and he travels with a traitor. Vilquar's heart beats within your chest. If you ask, Vilqua's heart beats within your chest if you ask if I will hear him. Let's drink. Dakan says, will you close your mind to his words? Know your words before you speak your mind, Kina, Xerth of Xerthamon. I will not hear him. He will hear me. That is sufficient. The Khan turns to you and speaks in your language. She will teach you. The Gith woman turns to you. Her black pearl eyes glint dangerously. You are not known to me, but your trappings speak ill of you, human. Your body is a book written in scars and blood, and you walk in the shadow of a pariah that claims to speak for Xerthamon himself. Speak your mind. Shadow of a pariah? What do you mean? You walk with a pariah and you know not his history? He is quick to speak other words, but of his history he has remained silent? Ask him of Shraktalor, of the fall of a mighty fortress to the Githyanki, and see what his divided mind reveals to you. Ask him how he speaks with Xerthamon's words, but his karak is as mist. Dakan says, it is not Xerthamon's words that lack conviction. It is their echoes that have been distorted. There is no doubt in how Xerthamon's mind is spoken. Generations of Xerth are as Rakma's jewel, of one mind on this matter. Your stance carries with it a divided mind. The doubt is yours, an echo cast from your own faithlessness. Dakan replies, your words speak not the mind of Xerthamon. They are shaped of angles and hate, as if molded from a Gith's mind itself. You shall lie with the dead of Shraktalor in shifting chaos, for all you see with Vilquar's eye. For you see all with Vilquar's eye. Your mind is divided, your karak weak. Sheesh. Let it go, Dakan. Dakan reluctantly lowers his blade. Kina stares at him incredulously for a moment, and then a sharp grin splits her features. The truth, at last. Your mind is not divided. You are a slave to this human. He speaks with an Anarch's authority to you, and you listen. Alright. Dakan says, your mind is cast in Gith's mold, Kina. Let's go, Dakan. Kina says, you have lost your way, Dakan. Know that I hope you find your path. I pity you. Farewell. Let's go, Dakan. That was annoying, but interesting. So that says Kina. What about Halalian? There's another Githzerai.
All right.
I wish to speak. The man has a yellow cast to his skin and gaunt features. Tattoos and scars cover his body, and he wears a long blade across his chest. His eyes are like two small black stones. As you approach, he bows to Dakan. All beholden, Xerth. Dakan says, this one is numbered among the faithful. He bows. It is my will that you know this human travels with me. Will you hear me? Will you hear him? Simply had a few questions. His words are known to me, Xerth. His actions are not. His shadow speaks of one who has seen combat and bested all that stood against him. Do my eyes feel the sea beyond the still circle? Dakan says, your question flies true. It is my will that you know we walk the same path. Will you hear him? I will hear him, Xerth. He turns to face you and awaits your questions. Ask your questions. Direct them as you would direct your mind. Who are you? He bows his head to you. I am Halsin, a soldier of the Githzerai. I am here to gather supplies. I have discovered that this city is like Triigdor's gem, oft-praised, but little of value is to be found in it. The air is poor for one of the people, and those within it do not know themselves. They are empty shells. I see. I had more questions. Ask then. Where did you get your scars? I need a drink, guys, again. Hold on. He raises his arms and holds them to his face, then his chest, in a reverent gesture. The scars that bedeck my face come from encounters in the halls of Ilsenstein. My Rakima band was nearly devoured by cowardly Illithids. Mind flayers, guys. The scar upon my upper torso comes from the weak-driven blade of a Githyanki kin-stealer. He nods at your scars. Speak the history of your scars. Well, at least this one will hear me. The Khan says, it is a sign of honor to ask about one's scars. It shows respect for your history. Tell the truth. I do not recall how I earned most of them. His expression alters slightly, whether in confusion or contempt, you cannot tell. How can scars now tell stories of how they came to be? I have lost the memory of their past and my past as well. He pauses for a moment, absorbing this, and then... To Cha's lament, then, I mourn your loss of mind and history. Thanks. I had a few more questions. Where did you get your tattoos? They speak of the history of my kin and grant me their strength and minds. One etched by Argerac of the Isle of Seal tells me of my kin, Jilikai, who buried his enemies in the walls of Shraktalor. Another here was inscribed by Fel, the Davis who walks, and tells of the Battle of Roji and myself as we fought seven Slatti in the plains of Limbo before the Eighth silenced Roji's mind. He nods at your tattoos. Speak the history of your tattoos. They speak of the obstacles I have overcome, and the tales of my past, lest I forget them. He closes his eyes and bows. Your tales are noted, Swordringer. Thanks. You spoke of Fel? The Debus who walks is a master of the craft. Some tattoos tell tales, others tell of the spirit. The tattoos that Fel inscribes upon the skin lend strength of the body and strength of the mind based on the tale. Now I've been there already, I'm just curious what he has to say. What kind of strength? The tattoo of Roji, he who spilled the life of Seven Slatti, gives me strength in my limbs when I am faced by overwhelming odds. The strength lent would depend on the experience. Tell Fel your tales, and the tattoos will grant their power when the tale is placed upon the flesh. Where can I find him? You can find him in the Hive, in the northern part of the southeastern portion. The directions in this city are poorly given. They are like following the ravings of an anarch who does not know himself. Thanks. Farewell. Should we talk to the thug?
Done.
You see a young man with pale yellow skin. As you approach him, you notice that he has a rash that covers the exposed areas of his skin. Greetings. He turns tired-looking eyes toward you and then frowns. What do you want, Burke? I have some questions. His expression changes to one of exhaustion. I'm sorry, but I'm pretty beat right now. I don't have time to talk to you. He starts to turn away. It will take just a moment of your time. I don't have a moment to give you. Please ask someone else. Turns away. I'm surprised he didn't attack. Being a thug. Hell. Xanthia. Awesome name. Well, we got a bunch of people to talk to. And what is that over there? This thing. You see a pretty young woman in fine clothes. Her skin lacks the usual yellow tint of the inhabitants of this ward. She appears to be watching three nearby creatures with interest. Greetings. She turns to face you and an annoyed look crosses her face. Yes? What do you want? I have some questions. Fine. She looks irritated. Who are you? My name is Xanthia. She looks you up and down, then frowns. Is there something else you want? What are you doing here? There's going to be a fight, and I want to see it. She smiles wickedly. It should be interesting. A fight? Yes. See the three Thakola over there? She points to three hulking creatures with rippling muscles. They're going to try to kill an Abishai, she snorts. The stupid oafs. I've heard of something called an Abishai. What exactly is it? It's a lower plains creature, a Batezu, I think. She frowns in thought. In any case, Abishai have nasty dispositions, sharp claws, and can cast spells. Very formidable. The Thakola look like they can take care of themselves. Normally I would say yes, Thakola are very powerful warriors. She smiles slyly and leans in to whisper to you. However, I know something they don't. What might that be? Abishai can only be hurt by magic. She snickers. The Thakola will be slaughtered, I have no doubt of it. She straightens up and watches the Thakola eagerly. How do you know they can only be hurt by magic? She gives you an annoyed look. My husband is very high up in the Harmonium. The Harmonium guards are trained to deal with creatures such as Abishai. She looks away. That's how I know, my husband told me. Why don't you warn the Thakola? She wants to see the fight, obviously. Why would I do that? She smiles evilly. I'm the one who suggested the fight. Why? Drink. My husband tries to better his social standing with his underlings by drinking with them in the local taverns. Last evening he forced me to suggest such an occasion. These three oafs were there, boasting of their prowess as warriors. It was obvious they were there in a drunken stupor. When they decided to leave, one of them tripped and fell into the table I was sitting at. She pauses. Go on. She frowns angrily. Most of the drinks at the table spilled into my lap and ruined a very expensive evening gown. So, while the Cretan was trying to apologize, I whispered to him that I only accepted the apology of a warrior of stature. If he were truly such a warrior, he'd be able to defeat an Abishai in hand-to-hand combat. You're going to have them killed because they ruined a dress?
Updated my journal.
You obviously do not understand the intricacies behind this situation. She looks at you like you're an idiot child. I was embarrassed and humiliated in front of my husband and his underlings. She looks angry. Let's see, I have some other questions. What can you tell me about this ward? Nothing. She looks about with distaste. Were it not for the fight, I wouldn't be caught dead here. I must be going now. Farewell.
I'm gone.
These guys? Zurb. This huge creature stands over 9 feet tall. Rippling muscles support its massive frame. It seems to be engaged in conversation with the two similar creatures next to it. Greetings. He turns at you, greeting, and begins to look about. After a moment, he looks down and notices you. A look of confusion crosses his features. What do you want of Zurb? I have some questions. He gives you an apologetic look and shakes his head. Zurb not speak language well. Sorry. You talk Thorpe. The creature gestures to one of the creatures next to him. All right, thank you. Let's talk to Gert first. Gort, anyway. Same thing. He turns at your greeting and looks down and at you. A look of confusion crosses his features. Gort, greet small one. I have some questions. He gives you an apologetic look and shakes his head. Gort not speaking well your talk. Sorry, you asked Thorpe. He gestures to one of the creatures next to him. Alright, thank you. Suck to Thorpe. As you approach, he leers at you and laughs. Greetings. Looks down at you and gives you a friendly smile. What do you want, Smalley? I like these guys. They're friendly. And funny. I have some questions. You got a question. Maybe Thorpe got an answer. He smiles at you. Who are you? He smacks himself in the chest with a thunderous blow. Thorpe. He raises his arms above his head and shakes his fist at the sky. Mighty warrior is Thorpe. All Thakola are mighty warriors. He places his fists on his hips and glares at you. Who you? I don't remember my name. He nods at you as he examines your scars. You got mighty scars. You must be great warrior, like Thorpe. He frowns and nods wisely. You got hit on the head too many time. Not remember name. Someday, it come back. I have some questions. What are you doing here? He barks out a laugh and smiles at you. Thorpe here with friends. He gestures at the nearby Thakula. We're gonna barsh a flying lizard. He lets out a roar and begins to pound his chest with fists the size of hams. A flying lizard? He nods his head, then begins to make crawling motions. Lizard, you know. But it fly. He begins to flap his arms like a huge, misshapen bird. Eventually, he settles down and looks at you expectantly. You mean a dragon? He snorts and raises to his full height. Thorpe good, but he not that good. Someday Thorpe want a barsh dragon. He stares off into the distance with a longing expression, then sighs. But this not that day. Well, if it's not a dragon you're talking about, then what is it? Thorpe not remember what Xanthia call it. He pauses to think. It lizard, tall as Thorpe. Walk on back legs. Got wings. Got claws. Red in color. Things you say they called Abishai? He pauses, then shrugs. I've heard of something called an Abishai. Is that what you mean?
Updated my journal.
His eyes light up and gives you a joyful smile as he nods his head. Yes, Abishai, flying lizard. Thorpe and friends barsh real good. Thorpe be warrior of stature then. Xanthia accept apology. What's this about Xanthia and an apology? Thorpe take friends to tavern last night. Thorpe gets stinking drunk, fall on Xanthia's table, spill drinks all over her. He looks embarrassed. Xanthia say she not accept apology unless Thorpe be warrior of stature. So killing an Abishai is supposed to give you stature?
Updated my journal.
He shrugs. Xanthia say so. Thorpe not know. I love this game. What can you tell me about this ward? He stares at you for a moment, then shrugs. Thorpe not know. Thorpe new here. He gives you a childish smile. Thorpe here for fun. Yes, you're going to barsh an Abishai. He smiles and nods at you enthusiastically. That right. Thorpe and friends barsh. Can I warn him? I'm going to warn him. I've learned that Abishai can only be hurt by magic weapons.
Updated my journal.
6,000 experience. He gives you a worried look. Need magic? How you know? To cause some trouble. I don't like Xanthia that much. She's kind of a, you know, female dog. I've talked to Xanthia, she told me. He seems confused at first. Then a look of realization appears on his face. Xanthia played Thorpe for a coney. She lie. Try get Thorpe and friends dead. I'm afraid so, Thorpe. He nods. Xanthia not deserve apology. Thorpe free from debt to her. Yes, you are free of your debt. Thorpe, thank you. You save life. You save life of friends. He turns to the other Thakula and speaks to them hurriedly. After a moment, all three bow to you and each hands you a pouch of coins. Thank you. He smiles. You good friend. You deserve. I must be going. Farewell. I want them to join my party. You see Thorpe, the Thakula. He gives you a friendly laugh as you approach. Thorpe, good friend, the Smalley is back. What you want of Thorpe? He smiles warmly. Thorpe, not forget you save life. Nothing. Farewell. You see Zurb. He looks down at you and bows. Zurb, greet you, friend. Zurb, thank you for saving life. Turns away. You see Gort. He bows low to you. Gort, greet you, friend. Gort, thank you for saving of life that his. He turns away. So, Xanthia. You see Xanthia. She gives... You see, everybody. She gives you a look filled with hatred. You warned the brute, didn't you? No, I don't know what you're talking about. She smiles at you. Very well. Play your games of deceit. Know you this, Burke. I do not forget an insult. Good day to you. She turns and leaves. that might be trouble later. I don't know. Byron Paquette. Pickett, whatever. You see a well-dressed middle-aged man. He seems to be scanning the crowd with a practiced eye. He notices you approach and gives you a quick once-over. Greetings. He smiles at you and gives you a barely perceptible nod. I'm Byron Pickett, moneylender. May I help you? Moneylender? He nods again. Yes, I cater to the needs of merchants. Want to start a business? Keep one afloat that's down on its luck? Or perhaps expand a business? In either case, you come to me for the funds. He looks at you up and down. I doubt that you're a merchant, sir. So what can I do for you? I'm a merchant. He smiles and looks away for a moment. A merchant of death, maybe, but not the kind I do business with. He frowns. You insist on monopolizing my time. Please come to the point of the visit. Can you tell me about your business? He frowns and shakes his head. No, I see no reason to. Looks you up and down. You're obviously not someone I conduct business with. I think you should leave. Looks away. I have some questions. He sighs. Very well, make it quick. What is this place? If you mean the ward in general, this is called the lower ward. If you mean this particular locale, it's the open-air market. Tell me about the lower ward. He looks bored. It's the home of the common people. He gestures around. Look about you and you will see all that there is to see. Nothing. Nothing of any interest. Then why are you here? He smiles. The one thing these mindless sods are good for is spending their money. It gives them the feeling that they are actually accomplishing something with their otherwise meaningless lives. He pauses and looks about with disdain. Go on. He shrugs. Where there is money, you will also find merchants and thieves. I help provide the merchants needed to relieve them. I help provide the merchants needed to relieve them, he gestures about, of their hard-earned coin. He smiles at you. You mentioned thieves. Who helps provide, then? Not I. He gives you a calculating look and smiles. Why do you ask? Call it training? What kind of training can you give us? Call it curiosity. Whoa, 2000. He laughs. Such curiosity can be dangerous, even fatal if one isn't careful. He pauses to consider his next words as he examines you closely. You might want to talk to Lenny. He can usually be found south and east of the market. He pauses a moment. Tell him I sent you. Tell me about the open-air market. He gestures at the building behind him, an excellent market that caters to just about every need. He pauses to think for a moment before continuing. Nothing exotic is available. These sods cannot afford such items, but a good market nonetheless. I'm looking for some training. He laughs and looks around. Really now? Well, that's not the kind of thing you should admit to just anyone. He studies you while he thinks. As I said, I have nothing to do with thieves. Perhaps you should talk to Lenny. Okay, thief training? Never mind. It can usually be found south and east. Blah, 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 blah. Okay. I have some other questions. I'm looking for someone named Lothar, or the Master of the Bones. He gives you a quizzical look. Really? Why in the name of the Nine Hells would you want to find him? He stole a skull of mine. So? What do you think you're going to do? Just march in and demand it back? He looks you up and down. I admit that you appear more than capable of handing yourself in a fight, but against Lothar? He snorts. Your skull will decorate his walls. Just how tough can one man be? He laughs uproariously and gives you an incredulous look. Lothar is above the law, Burke. He is that powerful, that tough. I still need to find him. He pauses for a moment. I have reasons, quite good ones I can assure you, not to point anyone toward Lothar. Now pike it, sod. He turns away. Sheesh. This ruined wagon is quite useless. Guilt spur? It's on special. You see an anxious-looking man. He gives you an annoyed look as you approach. Greetings. Gives you a bored look. Hello. I have some questions. Then go find a town, he frowns. We'll only take a moment of your time. His frown deepens. I really don't give a rat's arse. So you won't help me? He gives you a disgusted look, snorts, and then turns away. Clueless sod. Very well. Farewell. You see the auctioneer customer. He waves you off as you attempt to talk to him again. You see a woman. She appears quite excited. She glances at you as you approach and smiles. Greetings. Yes, greetings and all that. You want something? I have some questions. She frowns and sighs. Please be quick. I don't want to miss anything. Who are you? What? Why do you need to know that? I'm just someone who's trying to bid on some stuff. I don't see that you need to know my name. She gives an impatient look. What are you doing? I'm trying to bid on some items that the auctioneer is selling. If you get to the point of all this questioning, I'd be able to get back to my business. What can you tell me about this ward? It's a wondrous place, actually. Just look around. She's got the peddlers, the markets, the auctions. She seems at a loss for words. Lots of stuff here. What can I buy here? She smiles. Well, just about anything. Except more of my time. Are you through with your questions? Not quite. I had some more. Is there anything of interest in this ward? She frowns. I don't know. I've lived here all my life and tend to take things for granted. She shrugs. Just look around. I'm sure you'll find something of interest to you. Thank you. Farewell. Yeah, I'll talk to all of them. Pretty interesting to talk to. For unnamed NPCs, anyway. You see a young man with a bored expression in his face. He doesn't notice your approach. Greetings. He jumps at your greeting and turns to face you. What? What do you want? I have some questions. Questions? Oh no, I'm busy. It will just take a moment of your time. I don't care. Turns away from you. They're pretty short conversations, huh? Uh-oh. Let's go in here. Alright, guys. Guess I'm not talking to any more townspeople. Well, the shadow's finally caught up. I don't know, can we kill it? Now, I know I mislabeled that 54, so I'm gonna go like that. Number two. Let's fight it. Let's see if we can destroy it. I don't know.